Hi, everybody. I'm Steve Anderson, the director of Meet the Robinsons, and I'm here to share with you deleted scenes from our movie, things that didn't make it into the movie. And as we watch them, I'll tell you about why they didn't make it in, and we'll discuss some really interesting facts and trivia about each one. Wilbur and Lewis have arrived in the future, and they're having their discussion in the time machine about Lewis going back to see his mom. You'll notice that the moment doesn't turn into the time machine crashing. In this version, Wilbur made up a lie in the moment to try to get Lewis off of seeing his mom by using the time machine, and said, "The time machine's out of fuel. We need to go back to my house and refuel it." What was a lot stronger about the idea of the time machine crashing is that it gave a physical thing for Lewis to be doing throughout Act Two, instead of just waiting for this time machine to be refueled, which was a lie anyways. So it was a much more dynamic and active way to turn the story at this point.
Shh. This is Captain Future requesting apology.
Shh. I'm sorry I doubted you.
And
for calling you crazy.
Captain Future accepts. Over.
This is incredible. Flying cars, monorails, moving sidewalks.
All brought to you by Cornelius Robinson.
One guy came up with all this stuff?
Yep.
What about that?
Yep. 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 Yep.
Who is this guy?
My dad. He's an incredibly talented inventor. Some even call him the founder of the future.
Robinson Industries, keep moving forward.
That's his motto.
Yeah. You know, Dad failed way more times than he succeeded, but he kept going and never gave up. And neither should you. And that's why you're gonna go back to the science fair and fix your memory scanner.
Hey, I'm not gonna fix that stupid memory scanner.
Just punching in the... What?
Wilbur, this is a time machine. Why should I fix my dumb invention when you can take me to see my mom now in this ship? I could do more than just remember her. I could actually see her, talk to her, maybe even convince her to keep me.
Lewis,
seeing your mom isn't the answer to this. That's in the past. Your future is with the memory scanner.
124.
What?
That's how many adoption interviews I've had. 124. Finding my mom is my only chance for a family. Why would I give that up for this piece of junk?
Yeah, it's just that. It's...
What is wrong with you?
Oh, this is bad.
What?
Just as I feared, the ship is almost out of fuel. We got a code red on our hands.
What all that sniffing have to do with that?
Soldier, I don't have time to explain every last detail to you. We need to get this puppy back to my house pronto.
Okay, okay. So after we go to your house and refuel, we can see my mom, right?
Let's just get home first.
Well, now we're going to meet Carl. We spend a little more time in this version meeting Carl, Wilbur interacting with Carl when they first get to the house. And once Carl sees Lewis's hair, Carl runs up the travel tube, we then follow Carl and Wilbur. After the travel tube incident, Carl goes and hides in the closet, and Wilbur has to coax Carl out of the closet and say, "Everything's going to be okay. We're going to be able to solve this problem. No worries. We're a team." You'll hear some great Harlan Williams ad-libs all throughout this. We chose to go a different route with this because for time reasons. A lot of the stuff with Carl tended to fill out these moments, and we really needed to keep the pace going. We needed to pick up that pace. So unfortunately, they got left behind, but we get to see them today.
Carl, this is serious!
Step back, little buddy. I don't know you anymore. You know, you've really changed since that time machine got stolen.
You haven't told anybody about that, have you?
You know I keep your secrets on the down low.
Wow, a real-life robot! Are you a fully functional anthropod? Are your modulators active? How many servos do you have? What's your name?
Come on, Carl. We've been in spots like this before. It's no big deal.
Oh, no way, man. You have really done it this time. Thanks to you leaving the garage door open, the time stream was altered, and when your dad gets back tomorrow, I'm gonna get blamed for it.
But not this time, because look who's hiding in a closet.
Come on, we can fix this.
Get away from me. Get on your skateboard and fly, little monkey, fly.
Carl? Fine. This could have been our greatest adventure yet. You and me, fixing time as we know it. But no, Wilbur Robinson's flying this one solo.
Don't be doing that. Look, you got me. I'm in.
Great.
So we had a whole subplot throughout our Act 2 that involved Wilbur and Carl's plan to boost Lewis's confidence. In a scene earlier, Wilbur and Carl talked to the Robinson family and said, I brought a friend over who has a lot of self-confidence issues. And the Robinson family, being very loving and warm, said, well, we want to help the kid. So the Robinsons then became part of the plan to boost Lewis's confidence. And now you're going to start to see this plan come into action. And this scene set up another scene that was deleted as well. So this is the Robinson plan going into action.
Now, a throw to Carl for the wrap-up. Pretty amazing story, huh?
Yeah.
Really makes you think, huh?
Yeah, about how glad I am that I gave up inventing, not about rebuilding the memory scanner.
Have you not been paying attention? Do you not remember the motto? Keep moving.
Look, I'm not your dad, okay? It's over for me. I'm just not doing it anymore.
So one little failure, and you wave the white flag. What if my dad gave up on his time machine?
Well, none of us would be in this mess right now, that's for sure.
Touché. But may I also point out that you wouldn't have gotten to ride in a time machine, and you wouldn't have gotten to see the future, and I would never have met you.
Look, I appreciate what you're doing, but try to understand. To me, you're the luckiest kid in the world, Wilbur, because you have a family, the most amazing family I've ever seen. And with this time machine and your help, I can be lucky too.
You had to play the orphan card again.
Keep looking, my pet. We'll find him. Aha! There you are. Now, to lure him out of the house. I know! I'll blow it up! Yes! Yes, and... No, it won't work. I'll be dead. Oh, I know! I'll turn him into a duck! Yes, yes, it's so evil! But I don't know how to do that. I don't really need a duck. Oh. This may be harder than I thought.
So, I'm still not clear on how long it takes to refuel the time machine. If all goes according to plan, we should be out of here by 8 o'clock.
Ah!
Wilbur, you okay? You must have tripped on the hand coming out of the rug!
Psst! Wilbur, sorry, gotta take this one.
Hi, honey. I wrote everything down on the cards like you asked.
Yes, you are mom with a capital awesome! And might I add, you don't look a day over 22.
You know, actually, I did get carded last week at the 7-Eleven, but I thought the guy behind the counter was just flirting since I only bought a banana and a Diet Sprite.
And moving along. Pass these out to the family and tell them to wait for my signal.
Okay, bunny.
Mom!
Oh, I'm sorry. 10-4!
Okay, sorry about that.
Is that your mom?
Where?
Under that rug.
What rug?
The one that's crawling away!
Oh, you're talking crazy. Clearly what you need is a nice, quiet family dinner with the Robinsons.
So now the big plan is going into effect, and we watch the Robinsons get Lewis involved in fixing Carl at dinner. The great thing about this one is that by the end of it, Lewis and Wilbur both feel like they're on top of the world. Lewis feels like, hey, I really can invent. I really am pretty good. I fixed this robot. That must mean I do have abilities. And Wilbur thinks my plan is working perfectly because now Lewis feels great about himself, and I'm only a few steps away from getting him back to fix his memory scanner.
I don't believe in fretting or grieving. Why mess around with strife?
Ladies and gentlemen, dinner is served.
Dinner is served.
Dinner is served. Dinner is served.
Meatballs!
Ready!
Put it in the hole.
Aim!
Get down!
Fire!
Impressive, little sister, but I fear you are out of your league.
Your words do not threaten me, brother.
So be it.
Put it in the hole.
Awesome!
Your meatballs are useless against me.
Then perhaps it's time for spicy Italian sausage.
I know you like a lot of PB&J on your meatballs, so I'm laying it on nice and thick, baby.
Attaboy!
Hey, I tried making one of those once, but it blew up.
Well, duh! That's the whole point, Carl!
All right!
Is dinner like this every night?
No. Yesterday we had meatloaf.
Give me the simple life.
Louis, we want to know about you. What do you like to do for fun? Do you have a girlfriend?
No. I keep to myself mostly. Besides Wilbur, I don't have a lot of friends.
How could a kid like you not have tons of friends?
Well, I guess people mostly think I'm just a little odd.
This'll come as a big shock, but some people think we're a little odd too.
One dragonfly in the rocks, please, Mr. Barkeep.
Hey, Frankie, baby! You gotta tell us one of your jokes!
Yeah, Frankie, how about that one with the bullfrog?
All right, you bozos.
So I turned into the bullfrog. You know what it says?
Ah, talking frogs! Perfect!
I says, hey, not with my umbrella, you don't.
Frankie, you're a riot!
I gotta go pee!
You bunch of goons.
Wilbur! We're all set for
Then it's time to initiate phase one. Uncle Art, it's time.
Me? Zounds, everybody, look what's happening to Carl.
Oh, Wilbur.
Carl, what's wrong?
I don't feel so good. I can feel all my belt tightening.
This is terrible.
Somebody do something.
Mark!
Everything's getting dark.
Put your hands in front of your face.
But nonetheless, Mother? Is that you, Mother? Tell the dishwasher. I love her.
He's broken.
Broken?
You mean he doesn't work?
You mean he can't make us food?
Now you can have quality rain gutters at an affordable price.
That's a piece of junk mail, you moron! I'm so embarrassed, I'm going for a donkey ride.
If only there was someone who could fix Carl. An inventor, perhaps. Maybe a friend of Wilbur's. But whoever could that be?
Oh, why didn't I think of this before? Louis is an inventor. He can fix Carl.
Oh, sweet Louis. It would mean so much to us.
Please help us.
If it would help, I could try fixing him if it would, you know, get dinner back on track.
Now, my pet, send forth the robber of dreams,
the ambassador of hate, the mother of all evil!
That's a good buzz. What the?
Ah, yes! You are now under my control.
I am now under your control.
Stop laughing.
Stop laughing.
Don't repeat everything I say.
I won't repeat everything you say.
Excellent. Well, I need you to repeat some of the things I say.
How will I tell the difference?
Well, I don't know.
How about a code word?
Oh, a code word! Yes, good idea! Let me see. Oh, whenever I utter the words, Simon says, you repeat everything I say.
Works for me.
So, Dr. Louis, how's our little patient?
Pretty good, Mrs. Robinson. I thought there might be a problem with his fluid access line, but it was okay.
There he is.
That repulsive half-witted fool. Now, my slave, seize the boy.
Bring him to me.
Did you not hear what I said, you idiot? Grab the boy and bring him.
Well, it's just that there's a million people over there, and I have little arms. I'm just not so sure how well this plan was thought through. Master?
Master?
Wow, a proton converter! And check out those transistors, they're perfect!
Okay, man, do it!
I guess I could double-check his hardware.
I'm alive!
You did it, Lewis!
But I didn't even...
I can see! I can feel! I can touch things! Hey, little butterfly! Hey, wall socket! Oh, Dr. Lewis Frankenstein, bringer-backer of the dead!
Hooray!
Yes, I really did fix him.
You fixed him good.
Yeah, I did. I really fixed him.
Nice work, my man.
No biggie, little raspberry.
A great moment that I really love and I also miss in the movie where Lewis gives Bowler Hat Guy the chance to take control of his own destiny and change the course of his future.
Ah, yes.
I'm only gonna say this once. Give me back my science project.
Ooh, make me.
Whatever you're thinking of doing, it won't work because I'm bigger than you and I'm smart. I'm bigger than you.
Are you through? Because you're missing the big game.
That's me, little Goob. This is the big game. Wake up, little Goob! Wake up!
What?
Oh, yes! I did it!
Phew.
I made the winning catch! Hooray! I didn't need to destroy your destiny after all. All I had to do was wake myself up.
I really didn't think this through. Thank you, Lewis.
My pleasure, Mike. I am never going to invent you.
All right, so now we have a different version of the wrap-up of our story. The first thing I want to mention is that the joke that starts this sequence is actually a payoff to something we had ran through Act One. This idea that there's a couple waiting to interview with Lewis while Lewis was at the science fair. And this is the payoff to that idea. And then it's a completely different wrap-up of Lewis's emotional story about finding his mom. He says goodbye to Wilbur on the roof of the orphanage and heads right to the science fair, sets up his memory scanner, and sees his mom on the screen. And it is in that moment that he learns the theme, keep moving forward. There's nothing beats physical contact in a movie. When you can make things active and physical, that's always better. And so the notion of Wilbur actually taking Lewis in the time machine to physically be with his mom on the doorstep proved to be a much stronger way to wrap up Lewis's story. So we went with that version instead.
Wait! Please come back!
Lewis!
Wait, Mr. and Mrs. Robinson!
Lewis, you have got your wires crossed. These are the Tambelines.
Hello, it's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. Don't worry, they're not the ones.
And how do you know?
Trust me, I know. Now grab your keys, we gotta get to the science fair.
Hey! There's the kid who blew up the science fair!
Ooh, this ought to be good.
Mr. Willerstein, I know what went wrong. Can I have one more chance? Please!
Camrips, why did you do that?
I built this machine to prove that someone wanted me. But I don't need to prove that anymore. Because I know there's someone out there who does.
You did it, Louis! You did it! This invention is brilliant!
Oh, Louis, I am so proud of you!
Kid, you're this fair's MVP!
Da Vinci, Newton, Einstein would be very proud of you, Louis.
Thanks, Dr. Krunklehorn.
Oh, please, call me Lucille.
Lucille?
And this is my husband, Bud Robinson.
Was it? Oh! Hey there, Louis!
Bud, you're Bud!
That was some show you put on. You're a real special kid. But, you don't look like a Louis. You look more like a...
Cornelius. I get that a lot. Ooh. Oh, no. Sorry, mister.
No harm done.
Frankie, what if I told you about running away?
Frankie?
My star pupil. My name's Franny, and I teach frogs mew.